Hello, I'm Craig Blake. The message you're about to hear, if diligently applied, will absolutely change your life. So grab your Bible, notebook, and pen, be ready to take notes, because I'm praying that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give unto you the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of Him, thereby allowing the eyes of your understanding to be enlightened. So God bless you. We'll be back at the end of the program. Now, every week we've been reading to you some testimonies, and if you would like a copy of these, we can make them available to you. We have them. We can get them to you. This is number 3. We just started this year of doing it like this, and we call it God's Witnesses to Divine Healing. Sometimes it's not always about healing, but most of the time it is. So this one we received from Northern California, and it says, since I connected with you guys a little over 4 months ago, I've seen over 100 instant healings when I prayed for people at the mall. I was connected with a group for over 6 years and never saw the results I'm seeing now. Like Brother Curry says, it's good to have a gospel that works. Amen? Amen. So, Sacramento, California. Brother Curry, thanks so much for the power cloth. Ooh, power cloth. I like that. After hearing your testimony of the man with Alzheimer's being healed through a cloth, I dug out the one you gave me when you were here the first time. This was in Sacramento. I gave it to my cousin that had been shot in the head and had some memory loss. About a month ago, while we were all sitting at Sunday lunch, Griffin, my cousin, started talking normal. He had speech problems also from the gunshot. He is still improving, plus his memory is almost normal. Thanks for the new way to minister. P.S. He had only worn it about 6 hours. So, amen. Amen. So, and the funny thing is, he said he dug it out. Apparently, when I was out in Sacramento at the Russian church there, a lot of people came to me and had me bring materials. They brought cloths and things to me. And so apparently he had brought me a cloth. I had given it back to him. And apparently he stored it away or something. So it's good to know that the anointing and power of God does not dissipate while the cloth is in a drawer. Amen. So, number 3. This is from Houston. It says, greetings to all JGLM staff. I visited headquarters last September. Several people prayed for me. I felt better almost instantly, but didn't see instant total healing. As I left, I started driving back to Houston, where I live. Before I got out of Dallas, I started saying that I wasn't surprised because I really didn't expect to see anything happen. Right then, it was like I heard a voice saying, and that's why I use their faith and not yours. If I used your words, you would stay the same. Right then, I stopped and repented, and when I opened my eyes, I could see perfectly without my glasses. I've worn glasses since I was 3 due to some chemicals that were splashed into my eyes. Doctors said my vision would progressively get worse, and it had, right up until the time I was healed. Hope to see you in Houston, Greg M. Then we got one from Zambia, Africa. Brother Curry, I saw you on Spirit Word TV. You said the AFM, that's Apostolic Faith Mission of South Africa, that's the organization that John Lake started when he was there in 1908. You said the AFM had agreed to accept your message. We need you in Zambia. Please come. Our people are dying and the churches have no answer. Bring your message and the power of God. Matthew. Oh, yeah, that's as far as I can go with that name. But because it's that long. We are going back to Africa. The AFM has agreed to sponsor me when I come in, that they're going to take us around to all the provinces, call all their ministers together, have us train them, and send them back to their churches. So once again, John Lake's message will be in the organization that he started there, and it is going to sweep Africa a second time. Amen? Amen. So those are some of the testimonies. Those are just a few of them we get this week. We pull a few out, but I wanted to kind of show the difference. It was healings, people ministering and getting results, people getting healed, prayer cloth, power cloth. We have to remember that. That's good. And then also from Africa. So now we also have a testimony. Where's Brother Ephraim? There you are. Come on up, my brother. I've been telling him, I wanted to give this testimony for like the last 3 weeks, 2 weeks, 3 weeks, something. And once I get up here, I get going, and you know, it's everything else gets blocked out. And so I'm going to let him give a testimony that he had a couple of weeks ago. I'll just let him give it. Everybody knows Brother Ephraim? Let's welcome him. Amen.
Thank you. I just want to give glory to God of the many things that God has done in our life personally. And me, my family, we just moved here, I want to say, 2 years ago. I'm glad I took the step, to say the least. There was a little bit of nervousness and a bunch of other stuff at the beginning. But anyway, we made the trip. We come down here, and literally, I can just, last night I was there awake. It was from 12:30 probably to close to 2 o'clock. I was just laying there, going down memory lane, as thinking the many things he's done for us. I mean, that I can't deny it, to know that it was God. From providence, from jobs, from finances coming in, from money being deposited to our accounts, from when we needed it desperately, from people coming up to us and just, well, shaking people's hands and $200 cash. And it wasn't so much of a miracle as them giving us $200, but we never told them anything about it. We didn't tell them that we needed money or anything like that. We just prayed to, well, Father. And I'm so grateful and I'm thankful that his promises are becoming even more and more a reality in my life. So anyway, I'm not going to go into detail everything, but about 3 weeks ago, 3 Sundays ago from this one, yeah, we went to a certain place, a congregation. And actually, he's a minister. There's a minister there. He's from Africa. I can't remember the place, but he's in a wheelchair. Or he was in a wheelchair, I'll take that back. I don't know what happened, as it wasn't an accident. He told me one time, it's been a while. Anyway, his legs just stopped working. And he had been in that condition for a few years. So about, three Sundays ago, I was there and I started ministering to him. You know, just telling him literally just the promise of God. At this point, I was even thinking last night, and I'm going to admit it. Sometimes, I've heard Brother Curry said, sometimes you feel it and you know it's your faith. Honestly, when this happened, I don't know if it was my faith, both of our faith, but really, I don't care. As long as he got help, you know. At that moment, there's like 800 people. There's 700-800 people or more. At that moment when I was, you know, just telling them and, you know, just literally just quoting a lot of scripture to them, all I could see was just him. I forgot there was 800 people there. All I could see was just him. And to me, as I was thinking about it last night, it almost seemed, I told my wife, you know, it almost seemed as it took place, almost like I scared that thing, or probably him too. As I said, you know, you've been in this condition long enough, this spirit of fear has held you in this condition long enough. I said, God has provided healing for him. Not yes, it's been provided long time ago. He ain't gonna come. You know, you hear, well, there, I'm not gonna say here. You hear things as, yeah, God is gonna come, you know, in his timing, you know, he's gonna do it. He's gonna heal you in his time. No, that's not true. God has provided 2,000 years ago. It's now. And anyway, as I was telling them, you know, your scripture after scripture, you've been in this condition long enough. And all of a sudden, I said, you know what? You need to stand up right now. And he literally stood up, you know, he stood up. And, well, we started walking. And the way back, we walked, I don't know, from here to that door over there maybe. And the way back, all of a sudden, he got like a real sharp pain in his leg somewhere. And he like stood still, you know, just kind of like shaking. So I just started rebuking that pain in Jesus' name. And all I could see was just him. That's all. And he started walking again. Two Sundays ago, I seen him again without the wheelchair. Now he can. He came on crutches. He had crutches this time. I had a brother said, yeah, that's good. And you're going to get him off those crutches. But anyway, I just want to give glory to God for that, that his promises are true. That they're not just yesterday or whenever, they are right now. If nothing else, it even inspired me more. Just when I saw him, it like encouraged me even more to see that. So I just want to give glory to God for Amen. His promise.
Amen. Amen. Well, that's we wanted to give him the opportunity to share that testimony when he shared it with me, and I like it because he's stepping out. We get testimonies like this all the time of people that are just stepping out and just many cases just talking to people on the street, in malls, in different places. And God, he sent Jesus to die for us, to provide us our salvation. He bore the stripes so that we can be healed. And too often we just let that just go right on past without ever applying it. And as what John Lake one time said when he was talking about Paul, when Paul was, he said he prayed three times that this thing would be taken away from him. And it's funny because it's about Paul's thorn, which everybody tries to bring up many times. But he said what God's answer to Paul was, Paul, my grace is sufficient. And what he was saying was, according to what John Lake said, was, Paul, look at all my grace. Dive into it. Dig into it. Take all you need because I am everything you need. And so I've always remembered that. Now, you know, one of the main things that, because we talk a lot about healing here, and there's healing and there's filling with the Spirit and there's the power of God, there's salvation, there's holiness, there's purity, all of these things. And we try to make sure that you get the full counsel and the whole counsel of God. But we want to give glory to God whenever we know that individual believers are stepping out and watching God do works in their lives. And we get testimonies. We've gotten testimonies just even recently of people that have visited here that came in with fourth stage cancer. That's metastasized, that is already back down to third stage and then goes back down to second stage. I mean, it's moving forward. It advances. People say, why isn't it instant? Many cases it is. I'm just telling you, there are times when it hasn't been. Now, here's the deal. If you believe in recovery, you tend to get a long, drawn-out, progressive recovery. Believe in instant. Go for instant. Push for the instant. Amen? Amen. Most people pray. The reason most people don't see instant is because they don't push into the instant. In other words, they'll pray, and then they don't get the people to do anything. And they just say, well, okay, it'll happen, don't worry. And they're willing to back off because they don't want to put themselves on the line to say, do it now. Like Brother Ephraim said, you need to stand up right now. See, there comes a point. The Apostle Peter at the beautiful gate told the man, you know, rise. And then the man didn't move quick enough, so he grabbed him by the hand and lifted him up. All right? So there's times if you want to see the working of miracles, you got to work it. Right? You've got to do something to get it going. There's faith, there's working miracles, there's healings, there's all these things going on. We're going to be teaching you about this year. We've got a lot planned. This year, and I'll just say this last thing before we bring our brother up. If you will remember, maybe not remember, if you'll think back and think about what you might have heard about D-Day, June 6, 1944, the Allies landed on the beach, but they knew that the success of that invasion, and therefore the downfall of Nazi Germany, every bit of it depended on their getting off the beach. Them getting to the beach was only half the problem, and a lot of them died getting on the beach. But if they had not moved on past the beach, then they would have been stopped and driven back into the sea, and it would have been a major catastrophe. So they knew they had to hit the ground running. They could not stay put. Now, the reason I'm bringing this up is because, just like my brother, I was up to 4 o'clock last night praying, talking to God, a couple of prayer requests on the phone, on the prayer phone, different things going on. But mainly it was just spending time with God, and this kept coming out. He said, you've hit the beach. Don't stop and camp. Keep moving forward. Don't let any of the momentum die, but push forward and advance. And so I was looking at our calendar this morning, I thought, man, we are definitely advancing. You look at our calendar, we've got people coming in every month. We've got different things going on. I'm intent on getting you trained and getting you active and getting the kingdom of God well established and functioning in this place, and this being a hub out of which ministries go and go into other countries. Teams go out of here and come back. I'm not going to be a part of all of them. I'll be a part of some of them, but I'm doing things and I'll be going out and in and out, but we're going to have teams that go in and out, different teams for different purposes and different places. And honestly, that's why you're here, right? You might've thought you're coming for a Sunday service. That ain't why you're here. You are here to be trained, equipped, and sent out. Amen. I expect you to be planting churches, planting life teams, moving out, going out and doing the things of God, and not just feeding off the testimonies of people that are doing the things of God. Amen? God wants to be alive in your life. And so we're going to make sure that you're equipped so that when you stand before God, you're not going to be able to say, well, Brother Curry didn't tell me. No, I told you, right? You're going to stand there on your own. Amen? Amen. And you're going to be able to throw at Jesus' feet the trophies, which are going to be healings and salvations and deliverances that were accomplished while you were here. Amen?
Amen.
So this is a training center. It's not church as normal. And so we want to make sure that you realize it is also literally an apostolic training center in the fact that we are establishing, growing, sending out, and planting in other works and influencing through the kingdom of God into these other works. Amen?
Amen.
So that's what we're going to be doing. So at this point, I'd like to bring Brother Waliki up, let him minister for us. And he's actually going to be able to stand over there because he has a wireless mic. So we will, let's all welcome him. Bless you, my brother. Yeah, just right over there. Pretty good.
My name is Ron Waliki. It's good to be here. I'm a missionary in Mexico. I've been there 27 years. And so I probably have a different perspective on life than a lot of you in ministry. Is that okay? A lot of times I think we get into a tunnel vision where we just perceive the kingdom of God in one way. And I think the kingdom of God is a lot more broader than what we understand. And living in Mexico for 27 years, it has really given me a different perspective on how the kingdom of God can move. Anyway, before I get into that, I just want to, I've written three books, just short books, on experiences I've had in Mexico. For some reason, God has used me in a number of deliverances. Amen. And so I left them back there on the table. If you want one, great, just grab one. If you want to leave an offering, fine. But Dispelling Darkness, Year of the Beast, and Beyond Ordinary. Because I believe we all have something to share. Amen.
Amen.
And I think one of our problems is we don't really realize who we are in Christ Jesus. And I think that takes a long time to realize who we are. And I was studying here about 2-3 months ago, and I was reading the book of Corinthians, and Paul says, as long as there's gossip and backbiting and division and dissension among you, you have lowered yourselves to be as mere men. And that just really spoke to me that I find myself doing what they did 2,000 years ago, right? I don't think I'm alone in this, right? And then I'll realize it, and I'll get back to flowing with God, and I'll get back to moving in the Spirit of God, and I sense a tangible anointing that comes over me, and then I realize, as Christians, I'm glad this church has this outlook that we are not mere men. And that takes a long time to realize, because you just see all your shortcomings, all your problems. If you don't just ask your wife, she'll tell you them all. Amen? Right? Is that okay?
Yes.
But, you know, the way that you perceive yourself or how the community or your family or your spouse sees you is different than God sees you. And if you want to, you know, walk in what God has for you, you're going to have to change your perspective of how you see yourself and start beginning to see yourself as God sees you. If my English isn't too good, I'm sorry. I speak Spanish 24 hours a day, okay? I'm just prefacing this with that. I would just soon be speaking Spanish. Para mí, mejor hablar puro español, predicar puro español. But I don't think everybody speaks Spanish in here. So just have patience. If my sentences don't come out that great, well, blame it on my teachers back in the 70s. Amen. Anyway, so if you want, you know, you can read testimonies of how I come to this point, because I've worked a lot in all different environments, situations. I've ministered in Mexico City. I've worked among the Indians of Central Mexico. I've worked in the jungles of South of Mexico. I've had to believe God. Amen?
Amen.
And I think God orchestrates times and seasons and situations where we have to believe God.
Amen.
But depends on our understanding of who we are, if we're going to see the victory, if we're going to bring God into that, and if we're going to bring deliverance and healing and health, are we going to bring the kingdom of God into that? Right? And I think it's important to understand that the kingdom of God is within you. Okay. If you don't like how I teach, I'm sorry. I love you. If you're not in agreement with it, I love you, but I'm going to be presenting some concepts that might be foreign to you. And a lot of these things have been taught for years, and I beg to differ with some of these thoughts. Like Daniel battling with the Prince of Persia. Would we still battle with that Prince of Persia? Amen. From what I read, Christ defeated him, stripped him of power, broke the power, and, you know, I don't think the devil has that much power over a blood-washed, born-again, baptized in the Holy Ghost, realizing he is not a mere man, but he is a man endued from power on high, somebody that's filled with the power of God. Amen.
Amen.
One time I called this person. This person said, "Who am I speaking to?" And I said, "Well, the Son of God." And it was silence and the other end. You know, I wasn't trying to be, you know, funny or, you know, arrogant. It just kind of came out of me. "Well, who am I speaking to?" "What are you speaking to the Son of God? How can I help you?" Well, we kind of cringe at that, don't we? Our human part just kind of says, "Am I really the Son of God? The way I live, I'm more like the son of the devil." Right? Puro santitos. Everybody's holy here this morning. But you know, amen. But we all battle with that. And so coming into this type of environment, it allows me to express what I feel and what I, how I act and how I need to be to bring about effective change in my life, in my family's life, and the people that are around me. Because we do battle against principalities and powers. Amen. Amen. Satan will move where he's not hindered. Amen. I worked down in southern Mexico, down by the Guatemala border a long time ago, and we were like pioneer missionaries, and I was amazed because there was not no light, there was not no church, there was nobody making up the hedge, that Satan had a free reign. Hallelujah. But then, you know, once somebody says, as men and women of God, we'll go into these areas because Satan perceives that these areas are his. Hallelujah. He's the God of the air. The Lord is the owner of the earth. Right? Satan has been defeated. The church has not realized that. Amen. To be honest with you, I don't fear the devil. I just don't. I don't fear spiritual warfare. I don't, people that are demon possessed do not bother me. I don't fear that. There's other areas in my life which are stronger, but for some reason God has given me insight and I've seen the power of God and I've seen that there's no devil in hell that can stand up to the name of Jesus. Amen. But they will try. Amen. Hallelujah. And so I let me share a couple scriptures with you. Scriptures that were fairly well known, but I'm going to present a different take on it. John, 1 John 4:4, really known scripture. Because if we want to see the power of God, and we want to move in the power of God, there's certain things that have to transpire. Amen. It says, "Ye are of God, little children, and overcome them, because greater," or the Holy Spirit that resides and dwells on the inside of you, "than the spirit that's within this world." You know, we all understand that. Mentally, we understand that. But when you go into a room, or where you go to a place, do you realize that you dispel darkness? Amen? Amen. If you don't have that revelation, that where you go, there's a river of life that comes out of you. Where you go, you dispel darkness. Where you go, you make devils nervous. Where you go, you bring life. You're a carrier, you're an ambassador. You are the Son of God. And dude from power on high, and just go in there and say, hey, pack up your bags, devil, you're gone. You know, amen? Amen. You should do that in your own house. That'd be a good place to start. How many are in agreement with me there? How many have relatives like that? We'll just stop right there. But that's how you begin to release the power of God from on high. You got to clean out all that junk. And my whole focus for the last 20 years in Mexico has been planting churches where there is none. Amen. Hallelujah. And so I'll go into these areas where there's very little gospel, or a church that has no concept of the victory that it should be walking in. Because people love religion. Religion, in one aspect, puts no demands on the person. Hallelujah. Keeps them in bondage. You're absolutely right. But there's no, you don't have to use no effort to remain in bondage. People gravitate towards religion. And Mexicans love religion. From coming out of a Catholicism, it's just so easy to go back under that bondage. Well, Jesus came to set us free. Amen. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. Amen? Amen. And so I think it's expedient upon us to find where the Spirit of God is moving. Hallelujah. You know, we quote down in Mexico, where two or three are gathered in my name, there is he. But my question then to them is, where's God when I'm alone? Right? Is that all right? He's right there. He's right there. He's your Father. You're his Son. Greater is he that's in the inside of you, or the one that's dwelling on the inside of you, which is the Holy Spirit that wants to come out, than he that controls this man, this world. Hallelujah. There is a lot of evil men and women in this world endeavoring to control it. And the times that we live, I believe it's going to become more intensive. But I also believe where sin does abound, the Spirit of God will abound even more. And once we can get our focus off all the negativity and all the stuff that's happening all around us and start to look to what God is doing, start to perceive who we are, start to understand we are not just mere men, but we are the sons and daughters of God with purpose and vision. Hallelujah. And we know hopefully we know what we're doing. We'll half know what we're doing. Hallelujah. Because following God, he don't lay it all out for you, does he? He just says, go to Ecuador. How? I have no money. Right? Go to Mexico. I don't have no money. I don't want to go to Mexico. Is that all right? I don't want to go over there. How many have ever presented your case before God? How do you realize that God changes not? How many know that it is a hard and dry land rebelling against God? How many know you can be obedient and still not eating the good of the land? Hallelujah. I went to Mexico mad, just mad. Like we say down in Louisiana, flat mad. I was mad. I was enjoying my life up in Northwest Montana. Did not want to go to Mexico. Did not want to leave Montana. Happy in Montana. I lived 30 miles from Glacier National Park. I was happy. P- apparently that didn't work out too well. And so finally God said, you're going to do what I told you or else. Well, I've been through some of the or else businesses a couple times with God. Okay, I'm going to date some of us here. I'm 56, all right? I know I look 30, but the cruel reality is I'm 56. When I was a kid, my mom had one of them wash machines, and she'd pull it out of one of them, the washer, and she'd feed it through these rollers, and it would just, and all the old, the not so, the young people at heart are shaking their heads and saying, and that would squeeze all the water out of these clothes. They'd come out flat. Remember them things? I've been through a number of them with God, and I don't want to go through any more of them things. Hallelujah. Some of you might be there right now. That's all right. Getting all the self-life squeezed out of you. I was obedient when I left Montana back in 1984. And I had started heading south because I was at Raymond 82 and 83. And God said, you're ministering outside the United States. And I thought, oh, this is glorious. Hallelujah. But when the reality hits to pack up and start doing all this stuff, that's a whole different dynamic. And so I got up Montana, God said, what are you doing here? And I thought, well, I'm living here. I'm going to raise a church, get married, and buy 5 acres, I'm going to build a log cabin, buy a couple horses. Hey, I got it all planned out. He said, well, I didn't call you here. I'm thinking in the back of my mind, well, I don't really care. I really didn't say that. I said, well, that's nice, but here I am. I like it here. If you've ever been to Northwest Montana as a young man, it's a great place to be if you love the outdoors. And he said, well, you know, I'll give you a little time, but then you got to go. And I just kind of forgot about it. And back then, it was a charismatic heyday, and we were doing these Holy Ghost seminars all over Northwest Montana. And God said, are you going to do what I told you to do? I said, not really. kind of remind you of y'all, don't I? And he said, well, you can do it or else. And then, you know, if God has a call on your life and he has something for you, it's hard to kick against the pricks, ain't it? And God will let you run for a season. Boy, I sure didn't plan on getting on this. Hallelujah. Anyway, and so I finally said, all right, God. I quit my job. My girlfriend left me. Who wants to deal with somebody that don't know where they're going? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And walked out of a church neck deep in unbelief. Didn't have no support. Didn't have no friends. Didn't have nothing. And I took off in a truck that did not have a call to the mission field. And so 28 years later, hallelujah, here I am. But I can say that willingness came after about 2-3 years of fighting with God. Because it says the willing and the obedient. I was obedient, but man, I was mad. Right? I had plan BM back to Montana. What a way to go to the mission field, just hoping it's going to fail. And I had another plan, BMQ, back to Montana quickly if the first one failed. But you know, the calling is a unique thing, is a strange thing, is a thing hard to understand. You either got it or you don't. You know, I was watching your musicians, and you know, you're either a musician or you're not. Right? And a calling is something like that. It's a special thing that God places on certain men and women. I was called. Didn't always want to do it, but I was called. And during the meetings, the Holy Ghost started falling. People started getting healed. People started getting set free. Amen. And if we can remember back 30, 35 years ago, messages that were really preached was, I'm crucified with Christ. I know these are messages that are not heard too much in today's environment, but there was a commitment preached from the pulpit back in the early 80s and late 70s. Nevertheless, he lives. Amen. Amen. And so I went to Mexico, And I didn't have no money. And when you're poor, people stay away from you in crowds. Is that all right? People like to be around successful people. And when you got a truck that does not, when you're evangelizing more mechanics than people, you know, you need a new vehicle. Hallelujah. And so over time, I got involved with what God was doing, got involved in a move of the Holy Ghost, got involved with seeing the power of God, started seeing deliverances and blind eyes opened and healings and just this massive influx of people getting born again and just seeing the power of God move, I was transformed. Amen. Amen. Because that's what it says in Corinthians. We are transformed from what? From glory to glory to glory to glory, which is a never-ending, perpetual work of the Holy Spirit in our lives. As long as we behold His glory. And so somewhere in Mexico, something transpired in me, something changed in me, and I found myself not only obedient, but willing. Amen. And aside from the violence, I love Mexico. I love the Mexican people. We have a tremendous time of ministering, opening up the gospel, opening up areas, seeing the power of God move. But I had to learn who I was in Christ Jesus and not to perceive myself as a mere man. And I know a lot of people will take that and say, that sounds arrogant and braggadocious, but I believe that's the gospel. I believe that's the New Testament. I believe greater is He that's in and inside of you than He that's in the world. If you're led by my Spirit, then you are the sons of God. If God's your father, well, who are you, a cousin? Okay, let me say that a different way. If God's your father, well, who are you then? Ambassadors? Filled with the Holy Ghost? Greater is He that's in the inside of you than he that's in the world? Amen? But I'm going to show you something in Matthew chapter 12, verse 29. Because I've seen how God has moved, and I've seen how the devil has had to bow his knee and give up space. Amen. Amen. And let me say, it is a battle. Amen. Amen. And it's a battle worth fighting. Yes. And a lot of times, we're battling over our children, our communities, our marriages, our finances, our health. We got to understand that this is a battle. A scripture, this is my own interpretation. If you don't like it, well, okay. Matthew 12, 29. It says, or how else can one enter into a strong man's house and spoil his goods, except he first bind the strong man, then he'll spoil his goods? And I heard for years, and it's still very prevalent today, if you ask the normal average Christian, well, who is the strong man? And they'll say the devil. You might even think that way. You might disagree with me, but if I read in Colossians, where Christ has stripped him of power, destroyed the work of Satan, amen, and I read in John 1:4 that greater is He that is in you than a devil that has been dethroned and been stripped of his power. Who is a strong man? It should be the church. Amen. It should be the blood-washed, born again, full of the Holy Ghost, the one the greater ones dwelling and residing in him. But because of our ignorance and our religiosity and our traditions, we give this power to Satan. Is that all right?
Yes.
And we allow ourselves to be bound. And then Satan is able to come in and wreak havoc in our lives. I have two daughters. I got one that's made me a prayer warrior. Y'all gotta... I bind them devils. As long as she's not married, she's still under my authority. Amen. I don't care what she says. Is that all right? I bind them devils, them lying spirits. I take authority and I release the blessings. In the book of Psalms, it says, declare the blessings of God on your kids. And my question is, what am I declaring? What am I releasing? Amen. Am I releasing blessing? Am I releasing cursing? Amen. Last thing we want to do is our kids to come home and live with us again. Right? I'm in agreement with me. Yeah. I mean, I love my kids, but you want to see them prosper and go on and serve God and be a more than a conqueror? That's what Paul says. He says, all these things that have come against me, yes, they affected my life, yes. But he says, I am more than a conqueror because I am not a mere man. Because a greater one dwells and resides on the inside of me. I am the strong man. Greater is he that's in me. Satan has been defeated. Start acting like it. Is this all right?
Yes.
This demon-possessed man, seven sons of Sceva, unborn, unregenerated, men not having the Spirit of God, saw Paul exercising demons, and they thought they could do it. And that demon-possessed man said, Paul, I know. Jesus, I know. Isn't that something that Paul and Jesus were put in the same category? Hallelujah. Jesus was the first born-again man, which signifies that there would be more. Hallelujah. Paul, I know. Jesus, I know. But who are you? I was down in southern Mexico a long time ago, and I was sitting outside this little ice cream shop, and this truck pulls up. And you know, I'm 5 hours from the Guatemala border back. This is 27 years ago. Just a lot more isolated, a lot more... there was no communication, and this black truck pulls up. Still can see it. And there was a North American sitting in the back of this truck with a hat made out of a straw. He looked like, I don't know, like Robinson Crusoe or something. And this Mexican said, hey, I found your brother. I'm leaving him here with you. I said, no, I don't know this guy. Take him with you. And the guy hops out. Amen? And really, I don't really... This is going to sound bad. I better think of a better way of sounding than saying this. I don't really try to relation with North Americans that come across the border from the United States and Mexico. God, that sounded bad even to me. Okay, we can erase that from the tape. And this guy was just full of devils. And he wanted to live with me. And he'd walk around. I was living in an Indian town where they all spoke dialect, and he's speaking English to them. I guess, you know, nobody understood anything anyway. I guess it didn't really make no difference. And I remember talking to him. He said to me, he said, I know you. And I thought, I don't know you, I don't want to know you, and I don't want to see you no more. Amen? I mean, you're in a foreign country, and you're not that well liked anyway. Hallelujah. And so if you got some wild North American running around, you don't really want to be associated with that. And he said, I know you. And I thought, I don't know you. He says, oh, I know you clearly. And it was some demons in him that I was in. I'm not trying to be braggadocious. I'm just trying to be transparent and share some things, okay? And because of the intercession and all the time I was spending in prayer and praying in tongues and battling against these principalities, that them demons, like they knew who Paul was, knew Jesus was, knew who Ron Wallachie was. And I went to a meeting, and I came back that night, and I found them walking around just talking to people in English. And he was trying to con money off me, and I saw a bus going down to Guatemala. So basically, I put him on a bus to Guatemala, gave him $3.50, and I've never seen the guy since. You got to be flexible. You got to be creative when you live on the mission field. Amen. Is that all right? Them demons that were inhabiting that man. You know, sometimes my personal conviction is if somebody don't want to be free, I don't think you can violate their will and their conscience to get them set free. Hallelujah. But I also see that madman that inhabited the graves and tombs and cut himself, that when Jesus came over, he ran and fell and worshiped God. Hallelujah. So it depends. I think that human spirit, our God-given right. But a lot of people like them demons. They like that power and that attention. Amen. And so anyway, so he says, Paul, I know. Jesus, I know. Does he know you? If he knows you, how does he know you? I'll just let that one just kind of ride there. We could really go to meddling, but we won't. Since I've had this experiences, I'm going to just share them with you. I was down there in down by Guatemala, and I was driving my truck that didn't have no missionary calling on it, and I got stopped by these 10 little Indians, and my Spanish at that time was non-existent, and so they all hop in my truck. If you've ever been in third world, if you got a truck, it just fills up quickly. And I understood enough Spanish to get down to this house. And I walked into this house. They said, brother, there's a sick lady in there. And I walked in this little house, and there was this Indian woman that was seated on these little benches, and she was talking in tongues. And the back of my neck just stood up. When you're in the presence of a demonic entity, your flesh just kind of is repulsed by it. And I said, well, she's not sick. She's full of devils. And they said, yeah, well, we'll do something. Right? And, you know, you got everybody looking at you. You're supposed to be the great white hope. And hope. And so it's either time to cut bait or fish. And so we started binding them spirits. And I can remember this lady, she's speaking. We were working with two different Indian tribes at this time, Zapotecos and Mijes. And she went to see a local witch doctor. And that spirit and that witch doctor came onto her and possessed her. And she was speaking in a different dialect. And so we bind and loosed and rebuked. And I could sense these demons of lesser power, these smaller imps, because in the kingdom of Satan there's a hierarchy, you could just feel them leave the body. Amen. And finally, the Holy Ghost speaks to you constantly during this whole time. And I still sense that the ruling principality was still inhabiting her. And so after much struggle, I could still see this woman. It was almost, you know, I don't think nobody's a really expert on all this deliverance stuff, but this woman just started pushing like this demon out of her throat. And then she was set free. The peace of God descended. We led her to the Lord. She got born again. We all went outside because we're going up to the top of the mountain to do a crusade. Now instead of 10 little Indians, I had 20 little Indians jump in the back of my truck. And my truck's going up the mountain like this. But since nobody tells me anything anyway, and since I didn't understand Spanish, and less dialect, everywhere we'd go, she'd be giving this testimony. I had no idea what she's saying. And finally, around midnight, because on the mission field, boy, you can be in long services. And she gets up to testify, and she said, this white person came, got me set free of these demons, and when the last demon left, I received my eyesight again. So 12 hours later, they tell me the lady was blind and got her eyesight back. I said, why didn't you tell me this like 12 hours ago? There's so much stuff that happens in the spiritual realm that we're ignorant of. We got to just trust what the Word says. We got to release. We got to bind. We got to understand that we are the strong man. Greater is He that's in us. And don't believe all that junk out there. How can I say this? Good God, they're never going to invite me back here. Some of these people that exalt Satan are doing it to the benefit of themselves. It all sounds dramatic, but in the reality is, in the name of Jesus, get out. I rebuke you, and I'm going on. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Satan will challenge you. Anything you do for the kingdom of God, you will be challenged. I used to go out to these villages, and I'd be walking in through the jungle, and I'd almost like meet an invisible entity that would come out to meet me. Amen. You can get tuned. You can tune into the spiritual realm without getting weird. All right. Let me just put that as a without getting weird. Okay. Is that all right? I mean, there's enough weird people out there. But we're spirit beings. We should be in tune with what God's doing. And the Holy Spirit was there to illuminate and show us and guide us. And these demonic entities would meet me at the entrances because they're very territorial. And they say, what are you doing here? I'm coming to preach the gospel. I'm going to raise up a church. I'm going to cast you out. Get out of my way. In Jesus' name. I don't have time for this stuff. Amen. Well, I'm on a purpose. I know where I'm going. I know what I'm doing. Well, hopefully I know what I'm doing. That's debatable. I present that I know what I'm doing. But we know where we're going. We're going to establish the kingdom of God. I don't care. I really don't care what the devil has to say about the matter. We're establishing the kingdom of God. We're planting the church. We're expanding. We're dispelling darkness. We're pushing back the kingdom of Satan. Amen. And wherever light can illuminate, wherever the light of the gospel goes, there is freedom. Amen.
Amen.
Wherever the light is, there is freedom. But there's ramifications. There's repercussions. I just want to read this story that's very familiar. I was up at Rhema last week, and I was teaching on this. And I think Paul is a perfect example. In Acts chapter 16, verse 5, because Paul was just a person like me and you. He had his fallacies, his faults, but he was committed, wasn't he? If you want to see the power of God, I'd say the first or second important thing that you have to have is commitment to God. Right?
Right.
I think we need to believe, obviously, but we need to be committed to what God's called us to do. You might not always like it. Amen?
Amen.
Okay, let me say this another way. serving God at all times is not fun. Y'all looking at me like a calf at a new gate. Let me try this again. Contrary to the prevailing mentality out there, you need to be tough to be a Christian. There are a lot of people that don't like me. The list is long and very distinguished. I don't serve them. I serve Jesus Christ. There's a lot of people that didn't like Jesus, didn't like the apostles, didn't like Paul. All these people, they died very violently. They were martyred. Amen. You get flowing in the kingdom of God, there's going to be conflicts. That's why there has to be maturity. A lot of times we're not experiencing the power of God because we're not mature enough to receive the blessing or the anointing. Amen. And when God allows this stuff to come on us, okay, I didn't mean to turn this into... One time I preached 4 hours in Mexico. Thought I hung the moon. I thought I was great. Okay, so I'm just warning you right now. I'm not going to go 4 hours. Nobody came back the next day, but for 4 hours I had them people there. Jesus, full of the Holy Ghost. What was he? Full of the Holy Ghost. Was led into the desert by the Spirit of God. For what reason? To be tempted by the devil. And after Jesus encountered all the temptations, overcame the temptations, the word says he returned in the authority and power of the Holy Ghost, which I perceive is a very distinct than just being full of the Holy Ghost. We got charismatics that go from seminar to seminar to worship, and they get full of the Holy Ghost, but authority only comes through conflict. Amen? And if you run from conflict, if you run from spiritual encounters, you might be full of the Holy Ghost, but the devil's not going to say, I know you. Jesus returned in the power of the Holy Spirit and stood up and said, the Spirit of God is upon me. Amen. To destroy the yoke of Satan. To preach to accept the year of the Lord. Hallelujah. To heal the brokenhearted. To give light, salvation. And so I would say, don't run from conflict. Understand who you are. Understand that God's with you. Understand that God has a plan. God wants to use you. He wants to reach other people through you. Amen. And if you have some crazy area in your life that's a besetting sin that knocks you down, get up. God's not falling off the throne over it. He's begun a good work in you. He knows that's in you. He knows that junk's in you. Amen? Amen. He knows you got attitudes and problems and all. I mean, you know, he's God. And so Paul and Silas, getting back to Acts chapter 16, they went about establishing the church. And they endeavored to go into, I believe, Asia Minor, and the Holy Spirit forbid them. And at midnight, Paul receives a revelation, a vision. Isn't it great when you get a vision? Don't you wish you got more of them? Or don't you want to have any of them? And so they said, assuredly, we gathered that the Lord has spoke to us. And they made straightway for Macedonia. And they got there, and the word says, and they were abiding certain days. That means nothing was happening. Amen. How many have God speaking to you, received something from God, had a revelation, had a vision, and nothing happens? spiritual things just don't always follow a certain pattern. And so they heard that prayer was being made by the women by the river. And so they gathered themselves, and Paul explained to Lydia, seller of purple, a woman of prosperity and influence, and she attended unto the things that Paul spoke, which was what? Repent and receive Christ. So we could safely say she was born again and her family got baptized, and things are starting to look up. We get a vision, we go down, people are getting saved, people are getting baptized, and they meet a girl that follow around saying, these men are from the Most High God that come to sell us the way of salvation, but she's demon-possessed. And you don't really want a demon-possessed woman announcing your crusades, do you? Hallelujah. And so after certain days, Paul said, in the name of Jesus, and he rebuked her. And the demons came out, and her master saw that the hope of their gain was gone, became mad, grabbed Paul and Silas, beat them, threw them in the prison. And at midnight, Silas turned to Paul and said, are you sure you had that vision? Are you sure you heard from God? Or if we ever get out of here, Paul, I never want to see you again. Right? Hallelujah. No, what the word said, it said, at midnight, they praise the Lord. Hallelujah. They praise the Lord. Why? Because God inhabits the praises of his people. I was sharing with Pastor Blake about 2 months ago. I was coming home from a meeting, and I live in northern Mexico, and there's a lot of violence and killings, and I was just driving half asleep. Maybe that's not a good way to say it, but I was driving half asleep, and all of a sudden a truck comes up, flies around me, slams on the brakes, and I slam on the brakes, and they wanted to kidnap me or whatever. And so my whole thing is, I'm not getting kidnapped. And so I whip the wheel around, and they whip the wheel around, and we're off running across northern Mexico, and I'm thinking, I'm doing 120 miles an hour on bald tires. This is not good. And I got these mafia people behind me, and I'm just praying, oh, God, help me. Oh, God, help me. Oh, God, help me. And I think the Spirit of the Lord rose up and said, why don't you take dominion over that spirit that's controlling them people? I thought, revelation. And so I became aggressive, militant, strong, however you want to define it. I bound that spirit that was operating in them men, and they just backed off. And I just continued on. Got back to the church that wanted me to stay and preach the second message, so I just sat there and preached the second message, and found out 2 weeks later that these men that were doing that were killed by the other drug cartel. Why? Because they violated their territory. I think is, don't mess with God's anointed. Amen? Don't mess with God's anointed. Are they perfect? No. Do they make mistakes? Yes. Do they say dumb things? Yes. But God's anointing is on them. Was Saul anointed when he was chasing David? Yes. Did he do dumb things? Yes. Do you do dumb things? Of course not. Amen. We need to realize we are not mere men and women. That should be your word today. Yes, we live in this world. Yes, we interact in this world. Yes, we have to work. Yes, we have to sweat. Yes, we go through problems and all kinds of situations. But we are not mere men and women. Hallelujah. How many are in agreement with me? Stand to your feet if you're in agreement with me, please. And I want to give this opportunity. If you need prayer, you need a touch from the Holy Ghost. I believe the presence of God's here. I love you. Amen. Forever. never. And if God's speaking to you, I'll give you this opportunity. You can just come forward. I don't like praying for people that are just, you know, I don't want to just see a hand. Let's, you know, be active in our faith. Let's just step out. If God's speaking to you and you need prayer, come forward. There's all kinds of prayer warriors here. We'd love to pray for you. Amen. Hallelujah. Alejandra, pasa ayúdame a orar por esta señora. Hallelujah.
Sing with your heart.
Amen. Whoever needs prayer, I mean, I'd get in front of the line. I have no problem getting prayed for. Sometimes I need prayer. We need prayer from each other. Amen.
I lay down my life for you, Jesus.
Hallelujah. God is good, isn't he?
I love you.
God speaking to you? Amen. So let's pray for these people. Just extend your hands. And the prayer team that operates here, if you want to come down and help us pray for these people, I'm not sure exactly what you guys operate in this situation, but let's just pray for these people. Amen. Hallelujah, brother. Just amen. In Jesus' name, Lord, we just right now, in the name of Cristo Jesus, we just pray for our brother. Oramos por nuestro hermano en Cristo Jesús. Rompemos todo potestad que está en contra de él. We just declare right now. We declare right now. We declare right now that the power and anointing is on this man. On this man, destroying yokes. Hallelujah. Rompiendo in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. We just release right now. Hallelujah. Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
I trust this message from the Word of God has been a blessing to you. If you need further assistance, do not hesitate to contact us at www.jglm.org, or you can write to us at P.O. Box 742-947, Dallas, Texas 75374. If you need prayer or would like to request a prayer cloth, feel free to contact us. Now, right now, I'm going to pray. God is going to set you free right where you are. God is not bound by time or distance. So in the name of Jesus, right now, I set you free. In Jesus' name, be healed, be made whole, be free in Jesus' name. So be it. Amen. God bless you.